Coming to you live from the Danforth University Center here at Washington University in St. Louis, this is the Getting Ready with Teddy radio program on KWUR Clayton 90.3 FM, and of course we are simulcast across the country via WUTV. The tremendous job that they do. We got Sammy Green and Andrew Ellison at the controls. We are most certainly in the best of hands. Happy holidays, happy New Year's to everyone. We christen the new semester and 2015 in style with the voices of St. Louis Radio. Good evening, Alexander. How are you today, my man?
I'm doing great. Looking forward to 2015, you know. Right? First show of the year,
first
guys.
Show of the year of the semester. Wow. We get a little bit of a new look studio. I have to give a shout out to my dear, dear friend, David Margulies, for doing the tremendous job designing this poster. It looks magnificent. And, you know.
Can I be honest about something, though?
Yes.
And don't take this the wrong way, because you showed it to me several times. It's more my fault than anything else.
Are you going to criticize it?
I am going to criticize it. That's what I do. That's why I'm here. Uh-huh. I'm thinking there's something missing.
Uh-huh.
That being, I want a little, like, parentheses, like, featuring Alex.
Featuring, you know what I've, you know.
Because
what?
I mean, the name itself.
Right.
Getting Ready with Teddy. I'm cool with that. You know what? You're running the show.
Right.
I get that.
Right.
But maybe, like, a little, hey, Alex is here too action. You know, that'd be great to have. And, again, you know what? On me. I saw this, like, four or five times.
Has Alex earned it of yet? Yeah, he has. Listen, this is the way I like to fit. First of all, Alex shows up to, he's having like a lovely dinner. Well, now, I'm not going to bash your dinner because I did get a beautiful, give a shout out to Alize Bell, this beautiful, like, I don't know what it was. It was like a truffle.
It's a cream puff.
It's a cream
of some kind.
Oh, it's delicious.
They have like a vanilla mousse in there. Ibby's, folks, for everyone who's on the Washington University campus right now. Ibby's, our four-star restaurant on campus,
right,
which is absurd in and of itself,
right,
has a new look menu for this semester. And I just wonderful desserts to end it. I still have some of my s'mores tart here that I'm really upset that I can't rid it. It's going to be difficult to eat on the air,
I think. Yeah, it's going to be a little bit difficult to eat on the air, yeah, especially because you get the whole thing in
your
face. I'm going
to get chocolate in my beard.
Right.
And that doesn't come out for weeks, to be honest. You get stuck
well,
with
you
that.
Just wipe it on the Tim's, like you were telling me before we came on air.
Yeah, I think that's what
Alex
has,
like, a big strip of like, ketchup on the side lace to one of his to his boots. It's, like, unbelievable. Me, on the other hand, I like to keep my shoes squeaky clean. I get a lot of flack for it, though.
And, you know, the thing is with work boots especially, you know, most people, you think, oh, you're going to see paint on them, dirt on them. You know,
right.
Stuff like that. With me, it's just food stains.
Right.
I just like, oh, wow, it's on my hand. I'll just reach down.
Right.
The problem is, I guess it's kind of, my mom would hate this. I just start eating again, and my feet were just, you know, my hands were just touching my feet.
You don't eat from the shoe, though. That's not what you're saying. I just want to understand you here.
Well, if I'm rubbing the shoe,
right,
and then I go back to my food.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Well, that's disgusting.
Yeah,
that's unsanitary.
Looking back, it's not the best idea.
No, it's not the best idea.
Watch out for Ebola, folks. I've been saying it for weeks.
Someone actually asked me, do we have a tagline here on Getting Ready with Teddy? I think that is our tagline.
Yeah.
Is watch out for Ebola, folks. But anyway, you know, this is just, we're jumping into my favorite time in sports. You got the NFL playoffs sizzling. You got the sizzling I'm going to use two times here. You got NFL playoffs sizzling, and then you got the hot stove for Major League Baseball sizzling.
Yeah.
The Hall of Fame, the whole bit. Basketball season starts to take shape. And for baseball, I mean, this is the only reason why I'm a baseball fan, is the transaction part of it. Because, you know, I'm a businessman by nature. You know what I mean?
A businessman, Teddy, yeah. You know, that's that Olin education for you, folks.
Right. Great Olin education. Great day today, by the way.
Yeah.
Third day of classes. Really getting into the swing of the new semester. So anyway, I want to start it off with, obviously, the divisional weekend leading into the championship weekend, and the Patriots held on in a wild one in Foxborough. This really was the game of the week. And talk about a game where it was really, it was a game of momentum. I mean, they just, between the first half, the Ravens were just chewing up the Patriots. Brady looked bad. And you know what? They were getting to Brady. There were times when they would cut to the sideline with Brady, you know, that stupid pom-pom hat that he always wears. And he looked like he had his hands in his face in the first quarter. It was bad.
Yeah, I mean, the big thing is that Tom Brady can't play defense, you know?
Right,
That's the problem
right.
for the Patriots most of the time, right? I mean,
right.
They're always so consistent with Brady out there. I mean, Baltimore played much better than I thought they would, especially against a team that had been rolling through the AFC this season.
Right.
And we saw Joe Flacco. It's hard to say of old,
Right.
Because Joe Flacco himself has been, for the most part, an average quarterback, but we saw him in the, you know, basically the Super Bowl level Joe Flacco.
Right.
Right. The team that, you know, that he took to the playoffs, like that was took through the playoffs, right, the Super Bowl, like that was the level of play. Well, he threw for a couple touchdowns, maybe three.
Yeah,
in the
he
first
did.
Half.
He had three touchdowns, no interceptions in the first half.
Yeah, and for him, again, like he's not a spectacular quarterback.
No, he's not.
But if he's going to show up in big games like this,
he's like,
you know,
Jimmy
Leyritz.
You know, he's like you can send him to a resort for the whole. I mean, whoever, get David grab. You know, you could send it wherever he wants. He comes to the playoffs and he is just money. And he was that was this Joe Flacco that we've never
and
seen before.
No hesitation.
No,
that's
none.
The thing.
Not
confident.
Scared. Confident. And he, you know what the best thing about that was? He was going after all the Patriots' big defenders. He was throwing at Darrell Revis. He didn't care.
And given this isn't the Darrell Revis of a couple years ago,
no,
right?
But it's still,
you know,
Darrell Revis.
Still Darrell Revis. He's still one of the better corners in the league, if not one of the best, right?
Right.
And it's the sort of thing where if he's willing to just go out there and attack like that,
right,
you know, I think Baltimore's got a shot to, you know, be back there next year and be in a good situation moving forward.
Right, that's true. And listen, their offensive line, you cannot credit their offensive line enough. The Ravens, I'm talking about, what they did in the first quarter, Justin Forsett had another outstanding game. Talk about filling the shoes for Ray Rice. I mean, Ray who? Unbelievable job that he did. 129 yards on 24 carries in this game. And then the other guy who stood out to me for the Ravens, Steve Smith, in that first quarter.
Is he like 50 now?
But he was in every single play.
Yeah.
Every single play, he seemed to be involved. You know, they're running. He's blocking. It was really unbelievable. And he's really answered to the loss of Anquan Boldin.
It's huge to have a receiver that you can just count on.
Right.
To get things done, right? If the ball's in his area, you know, or even if it's just a simple pass, to know he's not going to drop it.
Right.
Because a lot of the times, especially in big situations, right, big playoff games, you'll see guys get a little anxious, overrun their route, try to run before they catch the ball, and you know that Steve Smith's just going to get it and make the play that he's supposed to make.
Right. It's the truth. Listen, it was the story of the first half, and I mean, we'll get into the job that the Patriots did in a second, but the story of the first half with the you know, being down by 14 twice. I mean, after the second Justin Forsett touchdown, you really thought this game was, you know, it was starting to look like, you know what, the Ravens really pulled off something great. The Patriots looked a little bit slow, but don't count them out.
I mean, I was scared at the beginning, right? I had been walking in and out for most of the game, most of the first half especially, and I'm saying to myself, I said a few weeks ago, I was the one saying the Patriots are going to be representing the AFC in the Super Bowl.
Right.
And I was nervous to have my team knocked out. My playoff predictions were going to be almost as bad as my baseball ones were.
Right. They were pretty terrible.
If I lose my Super Bowl team that quickly, I hate to say, like, thanks that they came. I hate them.
You know,
hate them so much.
I know you hate them. I like to see them do well because as a Giants fan, I beat them already. It doesn't matter to me.
Twice.
I know we suck right now, but I beat Tom Brady and Bill Belichick. So they want to go out and they want to stick it to the Jets and they want to stick it to the Ravens and this and that and whoever they want, they can keep sticking it wherever because they are I would like to see Tom Brady win one more Super Bowl.
And look, the one thing I can definitely say too, going back to your Giants comment, is that as much as everybody, like the Patriots are the team that everybody loves to hate in the NFL. And let me tell you, everybody hates the Patriots.
Right.
But the one thing that's hated more than the Patriots is the Giants in the eyes of New Englanders.
That's the
truth. They
That is
hate
the truth.
The
Talk
Giants.
About having a bullseye on my back.
Yeah, I mean, they're asking for it. But
I shouldn't
be
looking for internships up in Boston any summer soon, no?
Well, don't walk around in a Giants sweatshirt while you're up there. that's the only advice I have to give you.
Right.
Yeah.
But they really, listen, you got to give a lot of credit to them. You got to give a lot of credit to Brady and Belichick, the job that they did. You know, they had, in the first quarter, the first half, you could still see there were signs of life for that Patriot team. Rob Gronkowski, again, was unguardable, and this is really a head-scratcher to me because, I don't know, you tell me, I would think that if you're Harbaugh and you're going into this game, you're thinking, all right, the one thing that I need to make sure of is that they're not going to beat me with my best weapon, or with their best weapon. And Rob Gronkowski,
How do you stop him?
You figure it out.
You can't put a corner on him because he's too big. You can't put a middle linebacker on him because they can't keep up with the speed. You know, he's like, almost single-handedly going to change the way
Right.
the tight end plays. because a lot of teams aim their tight end towards their running game, towards being a good blocker.
Right.
And, of course, there are teams that have that smaller tight end who they use towards receiving. You know,
right.
That's something I've seen with the Jets for years, for like guys like Dustin Keller, for example, right?
Right.
But it's the sort of thing where if he's going to keep being this dominant, and
right.
we saw the same thing with Hernandez while he was on the team
yeah.
with him, right?
Yeah.
The tight end can be a huge weapon
yeah.
if you can get the right guy. So I think more teams are going to look out for a bigger tight end that's got quick feet.
You know who I used to think was going to be that guy is Dustin Keller on the Jets. Remember him
yeah.
a few years back? I was so convinced this was going to be like the tight end of the future where, you know, he's kind of like a in between a wide receiver kind of tight end hybrid. Obviously, that turned out to be pretty terrible.
He was great. I mean, he was great as a receiver for
right.
them, right, for a little while. But the problem is he couldn't block,
right? Right.
Gronkowski's a big guy.
Right. He is,
you know?
A big guy. That's the
He's
truth.
He's going to get in your way. And whether or not, you know, I couldn't tell you how great he is on the line in general, like with his footwork and everything,
right.
keeping up with linemen.
Right.
Right. But he's still a big guy.
Right.
He can still knock you down.
Right.
And he's the sort of guy where, you know what, at the end of a game when you're
yeah.
throwing the ball into the end zone,
right.
you're going to put him on defense to knock it down, which
yeah,
is what they
yeah.
did, right?
You're
he's the guy
on.
Who's big and can. He's an athlete.
He's
he can
an
jump
athlete.
In the
he's
air.
An animal.
Dustin Keller wasn't big enough.
Right.
Right, he was almost just like a small tight end. He was just
right.
a wide receiver playing tight end. Is basically
no, you're
what
right.
we saw.
That's the truth.
Right, and that was the big difference.
Right. That's absolutely. By the way, did you see the Danny Amendola touchdown in the second quarter? He takes Brady hands it off. He shook like three tackles. It was like
a small guy too.
He is a small guy.
Yeah.
He's like a magician. I mean, it was really something.
That's quick feet. You know?
Right. I don't mean he had a Brady pass. Right. But you know, listen, that Kevin and the Brady had the touchdown himself, where he took it himself. You know, they were at the one, in the end of the first quarter, or the end of the first half. I thought when they got that intercept, when the Ravens
yeah.
picked off Brady to end it, end the first half, that would kind of put the kibosh on the little comeback that they were making.
The what?
Well,
go for it.
Second half, completely different story.
What's the kibosh?
You don't know what kibosh means?
What's a kibosh?
Puts the kibosh, like the clamp. Like a boom, you know?
It's like period, kerplunk.
Kerplunk.
You know
what
I mean?
They
what
put
is
the
that? I don't know.
It's a very wide-used terminology. I'm surprised.
You guys heard this before? No. Andrew's a no. Sammy, no? No. So
You've
we
never
got
heard that term
so
before?
So three out of four in the room. Don't tell me widely used. Yeah.
It's a very widely used thing. I mean,
in the Drucker household, I'm sure. Yeah.
I'm very surprised.
Uh-huh.
But anyway, I mean, you know, Brady was really an artist in the second half of this game. What he would do is the Ravens were nixing everything down the field, so Brady was bringing them back in. Shorter
yeah.
passes, Amendola here, Gronkowski there, 2 yards, 3 yards, whatever, and they were moving the chains, doing well, and then that sets up the play where the Julian Edelman touchdown pass to Danny
absurd.
Amendola. Unbelievable.
That's one of those moments where I just say, I hate Bill Belichick.
Right. But you know what?
I mean, here's the thing. Like, as much as I hate the Patriots, like, why do I hate them, right? I hate them because they win.
Right.
Right? I mean, of course, they did have the cheating scandals,
right.
you know, earlier in the 2000s, right? But it's just, it's the sort of thing where they're now at least just consistently dominant.
Yeah.
Just with solid play and smart plays like that.
Really smart play.
Like, that was unbelievable to watch.
But you know what, Terry? Julian Edelman was a quarterback in college. If you're the Ravens, you gotta... I'm not saying you have to defend against that play, because who's gonna know that he's gonna do something like that?
I mean, a quarterback in college...
Right.
Right, and, like, an NFL quarterback are two very different things, right? To expect a guy to make a throw like that...
Right.
I mean, think about it. When did he leave college, right? He's been in the league for a little while now.
Right.
Right, so he hasn't probably... You know, I don't know. I mean, I'm sure they were practicing that play quite a bit, but
right.
in general, you can't expect him to make that play.
Apparently, he's been waiting to do that for a long time.
And
he's been kind of working.
That's,
right.
you know,
that's a real
cojones
ballsy
right
time.
There,
yeah, that is some cojones. And then, you know, of course, that sets up the beautiful throw, Brady to Amendola. It kind of sums up what Brady did. You know, it just another spectacular performance. And moving forward, you know, this is going to be a scary team to watch. Now,
yeah.
Terry, for the second year in a row, the Denver Broncos... Little choke, little coming up short in the clutch, whatever you want to call it, but they are left with another playoff debacle after the goose
I'm
egg.
I'm so disappointed. I got to be honest. I have been, you know, especially last year when
right.
they were in the Super Bowl, I was pulling so hard for Peyton Manning.
Right.
Because I'm very much, like, I liked the idea that I got to see the best, you know, of this player, right? Like, I love the idea of pushing, like, LeBron as the best basketball player ever, and I wanted to say Peyton. I saw Peyton Manning. Peyton Manning was the best quarterback ever.
Right.
can't win in the playoffs. You know, he's not going to.
It's really unbelievable.
If you can't win the playoffs,
right.
You can't be the best quarterback.
And this is
ever.
Now that you have the first Super Bowl that he lost against the Steelers, right? Was that the Steelers Super Bowl?
I couldn't even tell you.
Okay.
That,
no. And then he's got the second, obviously, the Super
won,
Bowl last
yeah.
year. Now this, I mean, this is really, at this point, you know, now this is the third really glaring playoff loss where you walk away scratching your head. Now, listen, give him, you know, apparently he was playing with a torn quad for the last month. And you've heard experts around the league talking about how he's not the same. But you know what? At some point in time, he's Peyton Manning or an NFL quarterback. This is not the first time that I've heard of someone who's playing on one foot. You're a professional athlete. You got to learn how to do it.
You got to keep in mind, though, a player of his age. And you see the way he plays now.
Right.
You know, if he ever sees too much pressure from the defense, he
right.
just collapses.
Right.
You know, he knows how close he is
right.
to the end of his career, whether it be on his own or by getting hit by one of these NFL linemen.
Right.
Right. And he knows what's best for the team. He understands that in certain situations he has to force himself to play.
Right.
But a guy his age, right, and I'm not saying he's mobile. He never was mobile.
No.
Right. But this is something where he's going to have to compensate
yeah,
and throw a different
saying.
Way. And he's not going to be in the same page. But you know what? He's still Peyton Manning. And you still have expectations for him because, frankly, even over the past few weeks, he hasn't been himself.
Aaron Rodgers won this week. He was playing on one leg.
What's the age difference there? 10 years?
Listen, I understand your point. You know, but this is just really disappointing for, you know, for Broncos fans. This was a win or bust year, and it was a bust. And now, you know, you hear Peyton before the playoffs. Oh, I'm coming back. After the game, he was not so sure. He said, I can't answer that at this time.
Yeah,
interesting,
he
right?
He was saying that about a week before the game.
Right.
Where he had gotten a question like that, and he says he's not really sure where he stands. And I think part of that may have been related to the way
right.
he was feeling there, right?
Right.
And it's the sort of thing where, yeah, you know, at his age, he's had obviously a successful career, a Hall
right.
of Fame career. And, I mean, who knows, right? Can you really expect them to be better next year, right? Can you really expect them to be as good as they were last year, next
right.
year? Yeah, I mean, that's, like, it's hard to see him go, but let's be honest, he would be leaving in a way on top.
Yes, that's true. But he could, the Broncos offense was just a little bit inept, you know?
Yeah.
What really sums it up for me is fourth quarter, they had a chance, you know, they had a chance to mount a little bit of comeback. They got a 4th-and-1 in the fourth quarter, and C.J. Anderson makes some Colts defenders look absolutely silly, puts them on the goal line, right? And they can't capitalize. And they wind up going for a field goal, makes it 21-13 versus 21-17. All of a sudden, you know, that's a big difference.
Yeah, I mean, the big thing there, though, is it obviously makes it a one-possession game for them.
Right.
If they can, even with the field goal.
Right.
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 So obviously, like, they're able to do that, and they're able to work with that. The problem is they weren't able to do anything in the
right.
second half besides that field goal.
Right. That's the
right?
truth.
And it's the sort of thing where if you're already weak in the first half, you have to bounce back. You have to adjust or something. And then they just got worse.
Right.
Right. He wasn't passing the ball well.
Right.
And
right.
their entire offense is based around their passing.
Right. Yeah. I hear what you're saying. It's a good point. But now we got the matchup that we've all been waiting for.
Have we?
Tom Brady. Or at least I've been waiting for it. You haven't been waiting for it?
I don't know.
Tom Brady versus Andrew Luck this Sunday night. And I'm going to use the word again, so don't get mad at me. Luck might have finally put the kibosh on the whole Peyton Manning, Andrew Luck debate. He's got another horse to go through in Tom Brady. And if he can slay this dragon, man, then you know what? ESPN, you were right. We should have been praising this kid when he was in middle school.
Look, I mean, for the most part,
when he was dancing
at
bar mitzvahs. Do you think he's been to a bar mitzvah?
I have no idea. You know, let's ask him.
We should. We'll
get
him
on the show.
Can we
yeah.
get him? Andrew, can we get him on the show next week?
Can we
book that?
We'll see what we can do.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, maybe pregame.
Right.
Yeah, we'll get him to call in.
Right.
But, I mean, the big thing about Andrew Luck is they're obviously, like, especially from ESPN's perspective, where
mm-hmm.
they have been, frankly, praising him since he was in middle school, it seems
right.
like.
Right.
You know, they had a field day. You say they put the kibosh in it
yeah.
in that debate between him and Peyton Manning, but
right.
you just know that while they were watching Andrew Luck beat Peyton Manning, that they were just, the producers were sitting there in SportsCenter just like,
licking
yes.
their chops, right?
We have, like,
let's
18 hours of coverage as to why Andrew Luck has officially replaced Peyton Manning. They're going to show comparative numbers for every single statistic.
That's
from,
tremendous.
You know, Andrew Luck's first X amount of years
right.
to Peyton Manning's first X amount of
right.
years. And then where's he going to go from there? Then they're going to compare the Andrew Luck-Tom Brady rivalry the way they do the Peyton Manning-Tom Brady rivalry.
Can we get some sports science in there? How about that?
Yeah, right? Oh, and they're going to analyze Andrew Luck's body. All right, this is his, you know, facial hair to face ratio. And
oh,
like,
he's got a lot of facial
yeah,
hair.
Right? He beats
I'll
me
take
out.
Some of that. He can give
that's
me
what
some.
I'm going for. That's why I'm growing it out.
Oh, is that why?
Andrew Luck, yeah.
That's very funny.
Yeah, you know, this is the one problem. You know, I'd love to be on ESPN Radio, but God knows I hate them.
No, yeah, I'm not a fan of ESPN. I've never been a fan of ESPN. But I got a little bit of trivia for you. There have been two quarterbacks in who have gone through Peyton, then Brady, back-to-back. One of them's Joe Flacco. Can you name me the other one?
Mark Sanchez.
How about that?
I mean... You're asking me about the one team I can actually get trivia about, and it was also only like 6 years ago.
Sanchez has been the last guy. So now, can we compare Andrew Luck to Mark Sanchez? Is that fair?
Mark Sanchez is obviously better. I don't know how you could possibly make the argument he's not.
Fly, Eagles, fly.
Right?
Unbelievable.
I'm excited for the game, but Andrew Luck has been having trouble with the Patriots.
Listen, it's going to be a very interesting game. Colts are really looking more and more like the Cinderella team of this postseason. I've really been waiting
for
this.
I want them to do well.
That's a team that you can root for.
Yeah.
The whole story with the coach, with Chuck Pagano, you know, a few years back with the cancer. Really, really
good
story.
Chuck Strong.
I love that.
Andrew Luck's Chuck Strong.
Shaved his head.
Yeah.
Would you shave your head? You'd shave your head.
When I get a job.
Yeah. Well, you already have short hair, so I guess it doesn't really matter.
When I get a job, it's off goes the hair, but out goes the beard, you know?
Yeah. And the other thing, too, is that the Colts defense, really, I mean, they locked down Cincinnati. It's a good offensive team.
Yep.
And now they lock down Denver, another juggernaut. You know what? At some point, you got to start tipping their hat to them and say, you know, yes, the Patriots are an older, more savvy offense, which is not a great combination for a younger defense like the Colts. But there's a little, you know, they've been playing so well of late that you got to hope. There's a little bit of belief if you're an Indianapolis fan.
And, you know, it's hard to say, though, that you can get through. I mean, you said it yourself. Peyton Manning wasn't himself.
Right.
Right. And to get through now a Tom Brady, who frankly is kind of himself. You know, he's the same consistent, dominant, clutch quarterback that you're used to seeing, clearly.
Right.
Right. And it's just like, are they going to be able to keep up and do it again? That's the real question, right? Especially because they have, like this year alone, they lost to them, right?
Right.
They've been having their issues with the Patriots.
Yeah, it's the truth. They have. They absolutely have. And the Patriots defense right now is playing at a level that we haven't seen in years from them.
Yeah.
So, anyway, Quick PSA back after this.
Hello there. Do you recognize my voice? That's right. I'm a professional announcer. Companies all over the world hire me to make their offers sound more compelling, irresistible. I persuade people just like you.
It was a catch.
Right.
I hate that.
Right.
This is the problem with the NFL. Get the referees out of the way.
Yeah.
They have to make a call on every play, it seems like. At a certain point, it's a contact sport.
Right.
Right?
Right.
And so, like, they're always calling holding penalties, pass interference. Like, no one can do anything anymore. And now on the single play where everything was going right.
Right.
They didn't call a pass interference when there was a lot of contact on a receiving play, which they shouldn't have, and that was a great non-call.
Right.
But just ignore it for a second, right?
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. I mean, that one's a little more difficult to just say don't call, but it just seems like every single time these NFL referees are trying to get involved in something that they should just back off on.
Right. Right. No, I agree with you. I completely agree. I agree with you on your analysis. I agree that just everyone please give Dez the attention that he deserves for what a catch that was. Talk about sports science. Can I get a drum roll?
Unbelievable. The guy's
Dez
a
Bryant.
Freak of nature.
That catch. He jumped higher than three flights of steps. Sports science.
Sports science.
But yeah, I mean, absolutely tremendous, but I completely agree with you. The referees dropped the ball on that. I mean, they really did, and I agree. Get them out of the game. Get them out of the way.
Mean, just at a certain point, like, they're, like, unless it's blatant, you don't have to call it.
Right.
You know? Every play, there's a pass interference, right, that you can call. Stop being subjective about it.
Right. That's
true. Stop being like, oh, this one sure, why not? This one, nah. Right? You can't do that.
Don't give me this possession. He didn't have He didn't have
possession. He clearly lost it on the ground.
It's total garbage, Terry. It's nonsense.
It's also, you know, the fact that a lot of the times now there are now new rules where coaches don't have to challenge plays, right?
Right.
Where the referees will just go to the booth. Well, you know what? That's a play that makes a bigger difference than some touchdowns sometimes.
Absolutely.
Right? Why can't that go to the booth randomly?
That changed.
If they're going to do that, go to the booth on every damn play.
I couldn't agree with you anymore.
Right?
We're in complete agreement. I mean, it was really atrocious to see. And you know what else bothered me? At Dez Bryant's press conference after the game. Here's a guy who has clearly battled some sort of demons his entire life.
Yeah.
He's really making a He's making a conceited effort to be better. He really has.
And he's become a top three wide receiver in the NFL as a result.
Right. And
with
it's
his head on straight.
Right. And it's noted what he's been doing, but now all of a sudden he's got to, I mean, he, you know, you could tell, like, he was fighting back tears. And it's things like this must make him wonder, you know, what am I doing? Why am I being good? Am I, like, is this how I'm rewarded? You see what I'm saying?
It's almost, in a weird way, more, you know, disconcerting to see a guy broken up
right
over that than upset and blaming the referee aggressively. You know what I mean? A lot right of the times after a game like that, you'll see, like, especially if it's in the regular season, you'll just see him get angry.
Right.
But you could tell. I mean, you felt like that referee, right, just kind of pulled away the last 5 months
yeah
for Dez Bryant.
Yeah.
Because he just took it away from him.
Right. He did. Exactly.
That's what
exactly
they've all been
right
working towards, right?
Couldn't agree with you
more. Look, who knows, right? Because he didn't score on the play, did he?
Right.
Right?
No.
It's the sort of thing where maybe there's a goal line.
They ruled
maybe
him down inside the one.
Right.
Was the initial ruling on the field.
Right. So, hey, you know what? Maybe there's a goal line stand. Maybe they have a field goal. Blah,
whatever.
Blah, blah, blah.
Chances are they're going to score.
Chances are they're
going to score
a touchdown there.
Right.
And, of course, it's not fair to assume, but God damn it, that was the wrong call.
Right. Right.
That's it.
You just cursed on the air.
Did I?
Yeah.
Did I didn't mean to bring God into it either. I'm sorry, guys.
That's okay. Apparently, we're allowed to do that on
listen,
TV. Radio, it's a little racy.
And here's the deal. I hate the Cowboys. I hate
right
everything they stand for. I hate Jerry Jones. I hate America's team. Like,
right,
they're only American teams.
Right, right,
but,
right, right.
But
that's
you know what?
Truth.
I want to see
unless they get their team in London, which they're plugging real hard
yeah
for.
Yeah, right. I want to see them lose every time.
Right.
I want to see them lose every time.
But, not
but I don't want to see them lose like that.
I agree.
That's
I agree.
It.
I completely agree with you. It's just, you know, it's really painful for me to see. You do have to give a lot of credit though to Jason Garrett, who they re-upped
yeah
for a few more years. He did say all the right things after the game. He didn't blame it on the referees. And while you and I consider screaming all we want about how the referees dropped the ball on
yeah
that play, it was his job to calm Dez down, to calm his team down, and say, you know what? And he said, we had 60 minutes, and we didn't make it happen. And you know
yeah
what? He's right.
He's right. There's always more time, right? It's the same thing. You can't always blame one play.
Right.
And obviously, we're making it the focal point of the game. There was a lot of game. The Cowboys played great. They played
absolutely
a lot better than I thought they'd play.
Absolutely
and
right.
They gave a real fight to a team that I honestly do believe is better than them.
Yeah. Listen, another 120-yard game from DeMarco Murray.
Yeah.
That offensive line continued to be unbelievable. I mean, listen, and Tony Romo
didn't choke.
He gets drilled during the game. He gets hurt. He's hobbling around. One of the DeMarco Murray touchdowns, he couldn't walk, Tony
yeah
Romo. And they, you know, he hobbles off the field, but he did not choke. You're 100% right.
Yeah.
And you do have to give a lot of credit to the way that the Packers offense played against a very good Dallas defense. You know,
yeah,
Eddie Lacy had another tremendous game. He's really starting to push himself into elite running back status
yeah
in the NFL. And by the way, I don't know if you heard this, but when Aaron Rodgers was lining up at the line, one of the plays, he starts screaming out, New York Bozo, New York Bozo. And he was asked about it. They got this on camera, and he was asked about it after the game. He said, yeah, you know, it's whatever. It doesn't sound like what it seems. So I'm curious as to who you think the New York Bozo is, because New York was not involved in this football game.
Lord only knows. I don't know about Aaron Rodgers' relationship with people.
I mean, it's really, but I would love to know. That's something that I really would, you know, screw all this reporting on who's signing coaches, whatever. I want to know who the New York Bozo is.
There are a lot of Bozos in New York.
There are a lot of Bozos in New York, that's for sure.
If I were in New York, I'd be one of them.
Yeah. Well, you are a New Yorker.
Yeah, I guess I'm technically, if you have to use an adjective to describe like where I'm from, yeah.
Right,
I'm
right,
New York Bozo.
Absolutely.
Hey guys, how's it going? I'm Alex, I'm New York Bozo.
Absolutely, but just Rodgers was absolutely money during the second half of that game. He was hobbling around too, he's still hurt. That's going to
yeah
play a big factor.
He doesn't have a calf, it seems like,
right
now. But,
right.
And he's a guy who likes to run around a little bit, get out of the pocket.
Yeah, that's the truth.
And so that's going to be difficult for him.
Right.
But,
it's,
you know, maybe he'll throw the ball well. Hopefully maybe his offensive line can protect him, no shot in hell.
Right,
but, hey,
right, right. And then we have Carolina versus Seattle, and I told you before this game.
I hate
game,
how right you were about that.
It was a non-game. Please, listen, Cam Newton, they had a great comeback the second
yeah
half of the season. Ron Rivera did a tremendous job guiding this team, and he really, I think, is one of the better coaches in the NFL.
Yeah.
But they just, you know what, Carolina had turnovers, it cost them. Cam had a good game, but the Seahawks were better. Let's be honest.
Yeah, I mean, look, I think you know, more than 9 out of 10 people would have said that the Seahawks were going to win that game.
Right.
But, I don't know, part of me thought, oh, maybe they got a shot. The game was close at half. Was it 10-14 or something like that?
Yep.
Then the Seahawks just ran away with
it. Blew it open.
I mean, Cam Chancellor was so...
Yeah.
It was unbelievable.
Unreal.
Did you see the plays where he was jumping over the line to
yes
block the field goal?
Yes.
Right, so he does it once, for those who didn't see, right? And what was the initial call on that play? Was that an encroachment? Oh,
yes.
No. Oh, it was a false start.
False start.
It was a false start from
yep.
Green Bay.
Right.
Excuse me, not Green Bay, Carolina.
Right.
After he just jumps and clears
right.
both the defensive and offensive lines
right.
to block the field goal, right? They next, so they, you know, restart the play, go to do it again from, you know, 5 yards back.
Right.
And he does it again.
Yeah.
How the center wasn't ready for that?
Right.
Blew my mind.
Right.
How you can let that happen?
Right.
How?
Right.
How?
That's the
this
truth.
This one went through him a little bit, and they ended up calling another penalty on this one. Oh, it was, yeah, he hit the kicker.
Oh, yes.
Another classic right. example of what I was talking about before. Like
right,
at a certain
right.
point, I want to see a hit. I want to see a kicker get hit almost. They've been protected too much now.
Yeah, but this is the NFL.
Now,
the NFL is now coddling everyone. That's not going to happen.
Look, I'm not.
Get kicked out.
The rule should be this one should be a subjective call. Because frankly, if I make contact with you,
right.
that's different from me hitting you.
Right.
Right. It's hard to watch the punters and the kickers just diving left
right.
and right to get these first downs.
Right. Right.
It's really hard to watch. And
right.
That's a huge difference in the game that you have to see over and over again. And you know every single time that it's, you know, it's BS.
You're not wrong. You're not wrong at all. And, you know, how good was Russell Wilson, though? In the he goes on third down, it seemed like the Seahawks really were pinned in third and long situations on numerous occasions. You know what his numbers were on third down? 8 for 8 with 199 yards. Talk about he's a gamer. He's a clutch quarterback.
So if you go back around 8 weeks.
Right.
Right. I think we were doing a show, and I was talking down Russell Wilson, saying
right.
he's an average quarterback, and he's not a star. You know,
right.
he'll just get the job done. Have you noticed then from there, Seattle just started winning, like, every single game? I think Pete Carroll was listening.
I think he was too.
The
you know,
was
we do
assaulted.
Have a lot of reach.
Yeah, Russell Wilson,
numbers
too.
Are good
yeah,
right
I
now,
think,
too.
I think a lot of them were offended by my comments. they came out to back up their quarterback.
Right.
So
no,
but he's
call,
been great.
They should call in that case. If you are a player, I'm going to lay this out right now for all our listeners. If you are a player and we are attacking you and you don't like it, I welcome you to call in.
Come in studio.
Come in studio. You can come in studio, but you
yeah.
could also, you know, like I'm assuming
like,
they're not going to be in St. Louis, so call in, and we're more
like,
than welcome to have you on the program.
Yeah, don't
and
get
we'll,
too angry. You know, Andrew will defend us. That's the thing. You got us, Andrew? Good. Love to hear it.
Absolutely. And
he's
now this sets up.
In Taekwondo.
Yeah.
Not actually.
This sets up a NFC title game with Green Bay and Seattle, and a lot of this really does hinge on the health of Aaron Rodgers, because without him, this isn't a conversation. You know, the Seahawks are a really tremendous team. I've thought for a while that the Packers are kind of playing above expectations right now.
Yeah, they seem to be. I mean, their entire team is so hinged on Aaron Rodgers' success.
Right.
I feel like they're not that great a team. They have a good receiving core and very good quarterback, and that's kind of what they're working with. And I
right.
feel like otherwise, they're really not so strong anywhere.
Right.
But yeah, that's the thing. If Aaron Rodgers can keep good play while he's hurt, then I think they could be okay. It'll be a difficult game, though, because Seattle's defense is just on a roll.
Right. Right. That's true. All right. It is 36 minutes past the hour in the Getting Ready with Teddy radio program, and we are back. All right, it is 40 minutes past the hour, and we are back here on the Getting Ready with Teddy radio program on KWUR Clayton 90.3 FM, and of course, we are simulcast across the country via the Washington University Television Network. And for this Wednesday, January 14th, year 2014, Terry, we're going to turn our attentions now to the head coaching carousel that has been going on in the NFL. A lot of news to get to. Between the Falcons, Bears, Dolphins, Raiders, 49ers, But I want to start, of course, with the huge news with the New York Jets over the past 24 hours. They revamped their entire front office. Mike McKinnon, I think is how you pronounce his last name. I'll call him Mike Mack, Mack now for abbreviation purposes. And Terry, you know, I'm curious to get your take on this as a New York Jet fan, but from everything that I'm seeing, this is exactly what the Jets need. He is a player personnel guy, and from all accounts, I was reading an article that called him a grinder, a real no-nonsense guy. What is your take on Mike Mack?
Yep. They need that. I'm almost – I kind of – like, I loved Rex Ryan, and you knew that. I almost wanted him to stay. I don't think it's his fault, but obviously at a certain point – You even coaches understand. They understand that this league works. You just need to change a face.
Right.
Right?
Right.
And at a certain point, maybe a guy who's going to give him a little kick in the butt is going to get them some success. And look, let's be honest, they're not going to be good next year.
Right.
Right? The big thing for them right now, it might not even be enough about coaching. I really think it's the talent on the field that they have to focus on.
Absolutely.
But coaching additions
may
be able to help some players.
Right. Right.
Kind of get to where they're supposed to be or get to their peak and play a little better.
Right, I would agree with that.
I think a guy who is no nonsense, a guy who's pushing them, you know, really on them, is going to be good for them. And just, you know, it's sort of a, you know, from going across to the Giants, right, going across the other league, like, Tom Coughlin's like, honest players.
And listen, that's what they, and we'll get into Todd Bowles in a second, but I completely agree. The other thing, and I was, you know, when we were planning this show, it was before they had hired a before they hired Mack and before they hired Bowles, and I said the one thing, do not make the same do not hire a coach before you hire a GM. And I know it was a matter of hours between hiring Mack and then getting Bowles, but Terry, they made the right decision. They could not screw the pooch on that one again.
I'm wondering how they went about that. I'd imagine that part of their interview process was probably, who would you want as your head coach?
Interesting. You think that's how it went down?
Because for it to be that quick,
right,
and
there's
had
no way
conversation.
Right.
You can't make that decision on the spot like that. You can't have, you know, a new GM say you're hired,
right,
and then, you know, within a few hours just be like, okay, now this is the coach,
right?
You have
that's
to talk about it. You think you'd have an interview process. I really think that was involved.
Right.
Maybe they were interviewing coaches and they said to the, you know, the GMs, okay, if you were to pick this guy, who would you feel most comfortable with and why? You know,
right.
I'd imagine, especially this is a huge job for the GM coming into this role. They have to pick their coach, right?
Absolutely.
That's their first job.
Absolutely. That's the truth.
Right.
And he's, listen, you know, an argument can be made who's more important, whatever. That doesn't matter to us. But this is really, and, you know, and we'll get into Bowles. This was really, we'll get into the whole thing, him, Dan Quinn, whatever. I'm curious as to why they were, whether it was because Quinn and Bowles were the two best candidates out there, but why, again, they chose to go with defensive guys when, you know, they haven't had an offensive-minded coach for years. Years.
I mean, you give them an offensive-minded coach. I think it's the sort of thing where you want, as a team, and, you know, I think it goes along with a lot of sports, it's a different mentality. A lot of teams say, okay, I have a good defense.
Right.
I have a confident defense. Right.
Right.
A really very, you know, then you give them a coach who's offensive-minded.
Right.
Right, because the defense doesn't need as much help.
Right.
They're taking, the Jets are taking the opposite approach. This is something you'll see a lot, obviously, is that when they have a good defensive team, you'll have a coach, because the pieces for the defense are much more there than the offense.
That's for sure.
Right? So it's easier for a defensive-minded coach to work his entire team into a success that derives from successful defense.
I see what that's a good point.
Right, and so that's got to be their mentality right now.
Right.
And I understand the idea that, you know what, they don't have a quarterback, they don't have a great receiving core, like they know this and that and this and that on offense.
So go with their strengths and then go from there.
In the end, it's going to be easier for a new coach,
right,
for this team, right? It's going to be easier for him to work with a talented defense and a weak offense than
I hear what you're saying. I just don't – so what bothered – I wanted Dan Quinn – I wanted. I'm not a New York Jets fan. I thought Dan Quinn – would have been the best match. He's the sexy guy out there. He's the guy who's gotten the most glitter with how unbelievable that Seahawks defense has been over the past few seasons. And yes, the Arizona Cardinals defense was unbelievable as well.
Yeah.
But Dan Quinn really was my guy. I didn't give Bowles enough credit. And now it's just funny to me how, you know, now there's this argument, should they have waited and see if they could have gotten Dan Quinn? And I was talking to my friend before the show, who's a very big Jets fan, and he said, no, well, you know what, Teddy? The thing is, you wait for Quinn, who now is probably going to the Super Bowl. You wait for Quinn, Bowles is probably gone, given the amount of teams that are looking for head coaches.
Yeah.
So you're left. So now what if you don't get Quinn? What if somebody got, and then you're left with nothing. You're already into February, and you got to get the ball rolling.
Exactly, yeah. And for those of you who haven't looked Dan Quinn up, he's a looker.
Is he a good-looking guy?
He is the sexy coach. No offense to Dan Quinn. He's just, you know, Sexy is not the word to describe him. You know, he's,
Bowles is a good-looking guy, too, you know?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Good. Yeah. That's what the Jets need.
They need a good...
Rex Ryan's had weight problems in the past.
But Rex is a good... I think Rex is a good-looking guy. He's a little heavy,
he's
but...
He's got a little... He's got that extra skin thing going on.
Right.
Lap band surgery.
Oh, look, we got a picture there of Dan Quinn.
Lap band surgery didn't really treat him so well.
Right.
Actually, it did. Let's be honest. He lost a lot of weight in his tenure.
He did lose a lot of weight.
But, you know, when you get as... Just this, the, you know...
Okay. All right. Fine. Listen. Fine.
It reminds me of a character on Austin Powers movies, who I can't reference because of his name.
Okay.
But it's fat, and then...
With the B, right.
I
think our audience is smart enough to know what you're going for there.
If you know the movie, whatever. It's just a big, big fat guy.
Right, right.
But, yeah.
All right, that's fair. But listen, this is my thing, is that, you know what, honestly, I would have thought that the Jets, it's New York, and for a guy like Dan Quinn, who is a guy who I really think is going to succeed wherever he goes, and his team says it, Richard Sherman was talking about it this week, New York kind of would have been a good landing spot. That's not to discredit Todd Bowles, because here's the thing with Bowles. He's a defensive wizard, we know that, but it remains to be seen if he can, you know, he from all accounts, he's the same X's and O's as Ryan.
Yeah.
Antonio Cromartie came out and said that today, which is interesting to me. So it remains to be seen, can he separate himself from what Rex Ryan did?
That's part of what I was saying before, right? Like, I think a lot of the feeling in New York,
right,
is that they want Rex Ryan gone, not because he was a bad coach, but because he was Rex Ryan and they needed a new face.
Right.
Right? I don't necessarily think they need a new style of play. I think they need better players.
Right.
Right? They need better players and a little more confidence, a different drive, right? We've gotten used to a little bit of the Rex Ryan coddling.
Yeah, that's right? True. Definitely true.
I think they still need that same sort of... I think the play calling from Rex Ryan, I think overall, was a good thing on the defensive side.
Okay.
Right? And I think the way...
Yeah, but that defense hasn't been playing well the past few years. Rex Ryan loved to boast about his defense, but I'm sorry.
Well, this year they came in really hurt, and I think there were still a lot of strong points, right?
Right.
Like, they had a good line.
Right.
They're able to work with the good line, right? And that's something that Rex Ryan hadn't even been used to, right? He had been working with Darrell Revis for years,
right,
and Antonio Cromartie, right? Mm-hmm. Like, that's they had a strong secondary.
Right.
And this year they were depleted.
Right.
They had corners playing safety, and, you know, it's just, I don't know, they were all in their fourth and fifth string players. It was just really tough to watch, right? And I think maybe with better pieces, we could see not a great team, but a team that you can at least call successful compared to last year.
That's fair. Interesting to see the route that Woody Johnson is going here, where he wants to end this whole image of the Jets as a circus. And he brought in two guys in Mack and Bowles who are no-nonsense, fly-under-the-radar. They do their job. They go 9-5, and they go home, and they're not going to make a fool of themselves. You know, I'm not saying Mike Tannenbaum or John Itzik were fools, but you know what? It sure was made up with the head coach. And now they got two guys here who are really going to do Woody hopes is a professional job. Another interesting to note about Woody is the amount that he listened to his special advisors on this one. He brought in Ron Wolf, who used to be the GM of the Packers, and Charlie Casserly, the GM of the Redskins and one of the teams. It's escaping my mind right now. Casserly hired Mac before as a coach, and Bowles played for him. So if you think that Casserly wasn't having Woody's ear throughout this entire thing, you're wrong. So that's interesting that Woody, who's always been known as kind of, he's there as an owner, he's in the decision room making the things, now all of a sudden he might be saying, all right, you're the experts.
And that's something that, frankly, is a problem in a lot of sports, right?
Right.
Owners should not be involved in player decisions because owners don't know anything. They never played. They never coached. Right, they've never been in the locker room before they bought the team. So when you got guys, and it happens in every sport, you know, Jerry Jones in football, you got James Dolan,
right,
in basketball, right, for the Knicks, and then you got Woody Johnson getting overly involved too here and there, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's the sort of thing where these guys aren't the experts.
Right.
You hire a guy to do a job, let him do it.
Right.
Right? The GM makes a decision, the president of players makes a decision.
Right.
That's it. That's it. The owner's there to give the money. That's it. They make the money too, right?
Right.
Back off for a second and let
kinda
the guys
like,
do their job.
Kind of like alumni donations would be, right?
We're working on that. For
Noah
any
makes...
alums who are listening, throw some money towards Hey Pie. That'd be wonderful.
That would be wonderful.
Yeah,
I mean, Noah's the quarterback there, but, you know, he's got to have the funding. I mean, I can only do so much as treasurer.
Yeah. you got to start, you know.
I'm doing well. One hell of a job, though, right? We had our nationals guy, our fraternity sends a guy who works for them.
Our nationals representative. Brian Karp. Great guy.
Really, really
sweet
guy.
Hope he's listening
guy.
At the house.
That'd I
be
do,
really
too.
Wonderful.
Right.
Brian, if you're there, hey, thanks for coming.
And you know, Brian was looking at my books that I keep as treasurer, and he said that I'm the second best exchequer that he's ever seen.
Well, that's because, I mean, and look, Teddy, you're fantastic.
Exchequer means treasurer, by the way, for those who...
So you said you're the second best treasurer he's seen?
Right.
Right, so he's got his own chapter.
Right. But that's not who he was referencing, I believe.
Well, then he's only been to two schools. He was.
So then he's telling me I did a much better job than Vanderbilt. That's nice to say.
Vanderbilt.
I knew I didn't like those guys.
He went Vanderbilt.
Sorry, David.
And then here.
Right.
Right, so unless he... Well, he did have some problems, you know, treasurer at his fraternity in at University of Florida was stealing money from them for a while.
Oh, it was his fraternity. Who he said was the first.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So there was somebody who was stealing money, and just as easy as that would be for you, I hope you'd
I would
not
never.
To do it.
But that's the thing. It's unbelievable. I could pocket $2,000 right now, and no one would know.
He said it on the air, folks. Okay, we have proof. So just be ready for when that happens. Okay, good.
Get ready to roll back the tape. But yeah, I mean, it really, really interesting. And with the New York Giants, just real quick. I was dead wrong. I thought that Coughlin was going to be out. I still think that it might have been the better decision, but you know what? The overwhelming support that he's gotten, an outpour, you know, between Manning and Jennings and all of the, you know, they love their coach, and he's going to be here for another year.
Super
Bowls.
We'll see. And this is what the Giants do, right? They win one,
right.
And they suck for a couple years, and they
but you
win
know what?
One.
But Terry, you know what's also
what
I also think helped Tom Coughlin out in this situation?
Yep.
The circus that was going on across town. Took all the you don't hear a lot of people talking about the Giants nowadays, which, by the way, before like 2006,
before
Rex Ryan, all the attention was on the Giants and how Eli Manning, the aw shucks, this, that, not Peyton, like, please.
Well,
now you don't hear about it at
the
all.
The Giants were the team worth watching. Then
right.
Rex Ryan came in hot and successful.
Right.
Right, so he was a loudmouth who did well.
Right.
Right. They were on that show? Hard Knocks.
Hard Knocks.
Right, and that was like one of the bigger, more successful version seasons of that show.
Right.
Because the Jets were an interesting team at the time, right?
Right.
And then he just kept talking.
Right, and that's the truth.
So the media didn't go away. They knew they were going to get a story out of him every time.
Right, it's absolutely the truth. And then the defensive coordinator, I want to bring back Steve Spagnuolo. I think it's the fit. I think it makes sense. Let's do it. Why not?
Yeah, I mean, again, I think the Giants are in another similar situation. I don't think it's the coaching staff. They have a bad team.
Right.
You know, like, players on the field have to be able to execute, right?
Right, right.
And we just lost a banner.
We did just lose the banner.
You hate to see that.
You do hate to see
that's
that.
It didn't
I was about to take a quick break
Alex
anyway.
Altieri.
You think that's why?
I think you should say that.
All right. All right, well, so, you know, we're going to take a quick break. We're going to fix this. You're listening to Getting Ready with Teddy on KWUR Clayton 90.3 FM.
Selective Service presents easy ways to stay out of trouble.
When she asks, do I look fat? Say no.
And here's the easiest way of all to stay out of trouble. When a guy turns 18, he should register with Selective Service at sss.gov. It only takes a minute, and it's the law. Selective Service presents easy ways to stay out of trouble.
If something smells like feet, don't eat it.
And here's the easiest way of all to stay out of trouble. When a guy turns 18, he should register with Selective Service at sss.gov. It only takes a minute, and it's the law. Selective Service presents easy ways to stay out of trouble.
Don't make fun of the big guy.
And here's the easiest way of all to stay out of trouble. When a guy turns 18, he should register with Selective Service at sss.gov. It only takes a minute, and it's the law. Selective Service presents easy ways to stay out of trouble.
Don't call your mother, sir.
And here's the easiest way of all to stay out of trouble. When a guy turns 18, he should register with Selective Service at sss.gov. It only takes a minute, and it's the law.
All right, we're back here on the Getting Ready with Teddy radio program, and I've been instructed here to stand off to the side as while we were taking our break and I was fixing our banner. You want to tell them what you did?
I thought while we were making the you know, putting the poster back up, I thought I'd make a slight adjustment. I think it looks a lot better this way. You know, I like it. I'm a loose guy, you know?
Right.
Not too formal. I don't need a whole print with my name on it.
Right, written in green for Wash U.
I need to go to Kinko's. I just stuck some tape on it in case, I got a little feature going.
Right, yeah.
That's all I could have asked for.
Yeah. All right.
That's all I need. I'm content now. I think this is a great poster.
Right, yeah, it's the truth.
Yeah, I mean, great job,
you know?
Way to work that out. Thank you, Teddy.
Yeah, of course. David Margulies, he's the guy who made the poster. He didn't put your name in it.
David, great job. It's my fault again. My fault on that one. I should have said I wanted something. Right. I was trying to be too modest.
All right, NBA, the New York Knicks are just absolutely disgraceful. They've won five games this entire season. Paper bags over fans' heads the other night against Houston, which was hysterical to
me.
I mean,
New York Knicks fans are being a little dumb right now. Except the losing. They weren't going to win the NBA championship this week. They're getting a little upset, the whole not about this year thing.
But you
know what?
Keep
losing games.
No,
keep
come on.
Games.
No,
tank.
You're wrong.
Tank hard.
If you do that, you're going to put Derek Fisher in the worst position possible because here is a young...
There's nowhere to go but up.
But here's a young... But that's the problem. If you have a young head coach who comes in and right off the bat, he's not winning games and he's doing worse than they were doing last season, that's terrible. Because you know what? That means that now he's going to come in next year and all of a sudden he's going to try and be like a hard, you know what. And the players are going to be like, what's going on? Like, this is not the Derek Fisher we came to know last season.
It's the sort of thing, though, in basketball.
Right.
More so than any other sport.
Right.
A good draft pick can completely change a franchise.
Yeah.
One good player.
Right.
Like, that's what it takes.
Right.
It takes one Anthony Davis.
Right.
Right? To just light up a team.
That's the truth.
Just do great.
Right.
And this is the thing for the Knicks to continue to do this badly. And they're in a real fight right now with Philadelphia and Minnesota to keep this last spot. But they're holding on strong.
Right.
They can get a great player. They can get a top three pick.
Right.
And you can look at a franchise that has a direction to go in. And frankly, if they can get that great pick.
Right.
Right. And then Carmelo can get healthy because frankly, the Knicks are going to officially start their formal tank when Carmelo starts sitting out games after the All-Star break. He's been playing hurt, and we'll see how that goes.
Right.
I'm sure they'll be under NBA investigation soon enough.
Yeah, that's for sure.
But ideally, with some pieces at that point, something to work with, some more cap space, because they're going to have Bargnani and Amari off the books there. That's about 1.5 max contracts, maybe a little more. They can potentially get a guy like Marcus Saul, right? I don't know. Maybe he wouldn't want to leave Memphis, because Memphis has been great to him. But you know what? It's the sort of thing where I'm assuming he'll find this year.
Right.
He's not going to be able to make it that far with Memphis.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying the Knicks are a guarantee for the the championship next year, but frankly, it's easier to make it through in the East because the East is terrible compared to the West.
Real quick, your thoughts on J.R. Smith and the Iman Shumpert trade?
I think it was a great trade overall for the Knicks. It makes me regret the fact that they didn't trade Shumpert in the past.
Right.
Because they literally got from that
is
they got three players in that deal along with a second round pick for 2019. And they just waived them all, right? So that was just a dumb space. But the big thing about that was being able to drop JR's contract because he's going to be locked in for next year, and he's a real cancer to a team, his mentality.
Yep.
But getting his money off the books gives him another space for a good role player for the offseason. And again, basketball is the sort of thing where you need one good player. You need a second, right?
Yeah, you've told this to me before. And
you have five guys on the court. You have five guys.
How about the corny speech that Derek Fisher was giving? Did you hear the other night? I mean, they caught it on camera. He's like, okay, come on. You know, you're the same as them. You put on your underwear the same way. You put your hats on the same way. I mean, it's like, you know what it reminded me of? Like when you were in Little League and then the awkward kid next to you was trying to pump up the team. He's like, all right, come on.
See, this is a sign where he's coaching a Little League team right now. Everyone on the team is young.
Yeah,
you know,
that's the
truth.
You
got Cole Aldrich starting games. And if you're not a New York Knicks fan, you have no idea what I just said. Right? Like, this guy they're in a situation where they are in a rebuilding phase.
Right.
And it's amazing that this is in a situation where they have a guy like Carmelo Anthony on the team.
Right. Right. That's the truth. You know what? Triangle Schmeigle. Go out there and put your own mark on the team, Derek Fisher. That's all the time we have tonight for this January the 14th, year 2015. Another shout out to Sam Green and Andrew Ellison, the tremendous job that they did for this program. We will be back next week. Time is to be determined. Thank you, everyone, for listening. Good luck with Rush if you're rushing. Adios. Say what you got to say, Terry.
Quick shout-out to Mitch Michigan out in Portland for listening.
Wow.
We got a Portland listener.
We got a Portland
listener.
All I
have to say is the Portland Trailblazers are not the best team in the NBA.
How about that?
We'll find out more next week.
Have a good night.
Bye, buddy.